Are you regularly working with kids? And if so, is there an age that you have found by your vast experience that it is best for a kid to come hang out with you, or?
Randomly, not a particular age group. I mean, I'm not dealing very well with my own kids, right? So maybe a child.
Me neither, mate. They're a challenge, aren't they? I
My kids
love
are
them to
like,
bits, but man.
if you would hear my kids what they say about me, that would be really funny to hear, like, oh, look at the master, how he is in his home, like, I go crazy, I'm beating them with a practice ball or, jumping on them, and they say, oh, father, let me be, I have enough of your jokes, enough is enough, like, it's really funny. And then Linda, always moving around, dancing and going back, and we travel, and it's like the kids are like, I do not want to have that lifestyle, probably. They say, I just gonna be an intellectual, I will sit on the chair and I don't care if I'm fat. Maybe that's what is going on in their head. I can be teacher to others, but not to my kids. But not in particular any age group. I guess I would enjoy playing with any type of kid. So if I'm enjoying playing, they will enjoy it as well. And through play, we will probably find anything we need and what we desire for.
And because I have hung out with you for a weekend and it was great here in Hong Kong when you came. And I sort of felt when it was the play, I felt it was, dare I say it, Joseph, structured play. So you create a game where you and Linda formulate ideas and principles. You create a game, and the role of the game is to teach me the concept, as opposed to you saying, Andrew, move this way and learn this about your spine. My understanding was you create a game and then you just sit back and watch. And then I go, I using your words again, it gives me agency. And I go, well, I just learned that about my spine with the lateral flexion and rotation to lengthen out the abdominals there. Feels just really great. So that it's structured play, dare I say that.
Look, it can be structured. So you have a different type of games. You have a games impossible to solve. So you propose a games secretly, knowing that they are not possible to solve. And so you observe how people are always trying to find a new solutions to them. And you observe who quits first and who second and who
Oh, that's
last.
cool as hell.
And who would be like going on forever? No, there must be a solution if they. And so you see the people's desire to overcome something. Then you have a no rule. So you just set and you give an object, right? And from that object, rules starts to appear. Games starts to form themselves. Then you have a games in which you're constantly changing the rules and you're observing who is capable of adjusting to those rules, or who is getting more pissed, or who is getting like who just wants to play the first version of that game but not the second one. And so you can through those different little tricks find out like what actually they are missing probably in their communication, right? The initiation for that type of teaching was, when I was playing with my kids, hide and seek or catch me if you can, like I always give that example. It might be boring. People might have heard it, but I go to catch my son and he says, no, he cannot catch me now. And I say, why? Well, I'm in the corner. And I say, and what? Well, corner is a home. So he invented a rule while we were playing and then say, okay, we play again, da 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 da. Then I catch him again and he says, no, not possible. And I say, why? Well, don't you see that I squat? When I'm squatting, this doesn't count. It only so and that pisses you off because it always kind of evolves while it wasn't said before. And I said to myself, yeah, don't be pissed. This is life. You thought it was that way, but in fact, as soon as you start to play with that world and exchange the information with the world kind of changes and you need to change it with it. And if you want to remain your idea that the world should be like that, you'll be just smashed around emotionally or physically, or your relations will suffer greatly. And Andrew, there is this thing people then think, yeah, but what shall I hold on? I have no then authenticity. That authenticity is in your capacity to give yourself to the dialogue, give yourself to that communication, give yourself to it, embrace it. My teacher in communication, she said, when we were kind of doing, I mean, I was with her 8 years in teaching in university, and she said, Jozef, you sound the best when you say positive yes. And I always thought this was only about tonality. Like when you say, yes, that's the sound where I sound the best. There is the best vibration combination of mouth, throat, other resonating chest cavity, etc. There's a good mixture. But then I realized, no, she's saying more. She's saying, say yes, be embrace what is there, right? And don't say this or that, you know, like embrace it. Embrace it, make yourself available. And that's where you probably learn the most, because, you know, we are creatures that can maintain themselves in low entropy state. So we are in very special state. We are maintaining ourselves in a particular viable range, right? And we can be in that viable range only because we are separated. But that separation still requires a communication. But that separation creates a problem for our perception, because you do not know what's beyond that mark of blanket. You do not know what's beyond that boundary. You need to kind of find out from causes what was the effect. And so we are constantly guessing, and we sometimes forget about the fact that we have no idea, that we should not make a statement, because we really do not know. We can say, this is my best possible hypothesis from my observation, but I'm not really sure. So it's this kind of Zen story where you would say, don't know is the best way of thinking. I don't know, I'm not really sure. That's the very nice attitude in life.